I thank once again PlastiQuest and Madam for giving me this opportunity of once again talking to all of you all. This time regarding bilateral cleft lip. Initially, first time it was unilateral cleft lip, in which we did discuss in brief about the other aspects, the basic aspects of embryology and things like that. But we concentrated more on the concepts of unilateral lip repair, what we follow, the way the thought process goes. I think on similar lines, I will be talking about bilateral cleft lip repair today. And at the end of the talk, I will be also stressing on certain unique things, which are a unique problem with bilateral cleft lip. So with that, I should be able to broadly deal with bilateral cleft lip. And at the end of the presentation, if we have any cases to be presented by the residents, it would be great. We could discuss cases, their management, or just how we go about it. Or even if you don't have cases, you could always put up clinical scenario and discuss about how we could approach these cases of cleft lip palate. So with that, as I mentioned last time, it's always very important to know the morphology of the defect that we are treating. Be it the craniofacial defects, hand anomalies, whatever it is, until and unless we know the morphology of the defect, the deformity, the congenital aberrations that have occurred, it's very difficult to conceptualize the repair of the deformity or how to reconstruct the deformity. So as with other plastic surgical principles, I think that we should go ahead and analyze the defect in different manners, the dimensions, the tissue defect, the way the tissues are displaced, and that's how we can study it better. Now, obviously, in a bilateral cleft lip, the cleft is on both the sides, either sides of the midline. The midline element, what I mean is the columella and the prolabial element, and on either sides of this, there is cleft on both sides. Now, this cleft could be varied. It could be complete, incomplete. It could be bilaterally symmetrical. On one side, it would be complete. One side, it could be incomplete. And there are instances wherein a bilateral lip could mimic like a unilateral cleft lip. And on the other side, the cleft is microform and minuscule and doesn't become very evident. But once you repair the unilateral lip, then you'll realize that there is some other problem on the apparently normal side also. So it's very important that we analyze the deformity right in the beginning and to try to see how much the severity of cleft is there on either sides. So the first feature is that the cleft is there with varying nature, varying extent on either sides. The nostril in this case on both the sides is horizontally stretched. In unilateral, on the non-cleft side, it is apparently normal, except for a little bit of tilt of the columella towards the cleft side, the tip is tilted. Whereas in bilateral, on both the sides, it is horizontally stretched. Depending upon how much is the extent of clefting, it will be more stretched if it is complete and less if it is incomplete. There is also LR flare because on both the sides, due to the clefting and due to the abnormal attachments of the perioral muscles and perinasal muscles, the LR bases tend to get pulled laterally and then there is a flare. In addition to this, the bony base, which is formed by the alveolar arches on either side, even those are posteriorly placed. And because of that, the LR bases tend to get displaced posteriorly and laterally. The next feature, classic feature of bilateral cleft lip is the shortened columella. If you see this, the columella gets shortened. This is because the lateral elements of the nose, the ala, get pulled laterally, and the middle element, that is the prolabial, which forms the base of the columella, tends to get pushed forward. So what happens in the bargain, the columella gets shortened. What happens to the lower lateral cartilage is the dome, the medial crest becomes shortened because the dome gets displaced laterally and the medial crest gets displaced laterally into the dome part. So what needs to be done, that part of the medial crest has to be brought up and then that has to form the columella and not the lip element, which is to be the case earlier when we used to talk about columella lengthening. But now we know that the columella is in the nose and not in the lip, because the lower lateral cartilages have been obtusely drawn on both the sides. And this leads to shortening of the columella. Because of the shortening of the columella and the domes being displaced laterally, there is a broad tip which is depressed. And there is no prominence tip prominence because the domes of the lower lateral cartilages tend to get obtuse and pushed down. Coming to the other features of the lip, the white roll, if you see the white roll in a bilateral cleft lip is found to be more pronounced in the lateral elements. Whereas in the prolabial element, the classical features of white roll that we normally see in a lip are lacking. There are, however, few cases where you do find some elements of white roll seen also in the prolabial labial element. But most of the times, the white roll is missing in the prolabial element, and white roll in the lateral elements of the cleft are more pronounced. The vermilion, if you look at the vermilion, once again, the lateral elements, the vermilion are much better defined, whereas in the prolabial element, the vermilion is thinned out. You can hardly differentiate the dry vermilion and the wet vermilion here. But in the lateral element, they tend to stay for a longer time, a longer distance as we move medially. So we should know that there is enough excess of vermilion in these lateral elements, whereas there is a lack of vermilion in the prolabial element. Similarly, the white roll is more pronounced and more available in the lateral element as compared to the prolabial element. In addition to this, the gingivo-labial sulcus, that is the sulcus between the teeth, the alveolus, and the lip, which is normally deep, becomes shallow in this bilateral cleft lip. There's hardly any groove or that sulcus seen in this, in the cases of bilateral cleft lip. So we have to remember that we need to create all those things which are deficient in the medial element. First, the white roll, which is not very pronounced, the vermilion, which is poor, and then the gingivo-labial sulcus, which is shallow in this element. In addition to this, we also notice in bilateral lips, which are repaired, especially in male patients, that the hair follicles in this prolabial element are deficient. Once again, this is a matter of variability. In some cases, you do find good amount of hair growth. But generally, the hair growth, as compared to the lateral elements, the medial element have fewer hair follicles. So these are the morphological features of a classical bilateral cleft lip. And as I mentioned, the prolabium, which forms the central element, is the element which needs to be formed properly in the reconstruction. Now, this prolabium, the features of the prolabium can differ. And as I mentioned, the white roll could be totally deficient, as you see here, or could be quite well marked, as you see in this case, to a certain extent here, and once again, poor in this case. Now, this prolabium also differ in the dimension. It could be broad, it could be narrow horizontally, or it could be short vertically, or it could be just appropriate. So this prolabial element, again, varies from case to case. This variation we should be well aware of, and we should know how to use these tissues and how to decide on the type of repair that we perform. Then comes the second classical feature of the bilateral cleft lip, especially the complete cleft lip palate, bilateral complete cleft lip palate. Now, this prolabial element, the premaxillary element, is the bony part or which forms the tooth-bearing part of the alveolus, the central alveolus. And this also varies from from case to case. It could be in line with the alveolar arch. It could be two teeth, small one, or could be broad, four teeth one, or could be tiny, whiny, and possibly might not even support a single tooth. It could also be moving way forward than the lateral element. The gingival, the alveolar elements you are seeing here are much posterior, whereas this alveolar element is much further, almost sometimes measuring up to 2 centimeters ahead of this. And this has to be aligned in the line with this. So quite a difficult task. We should be aware that this is one aspect of bilateral cleft lip which can cause a great deal of problem in the way we treat a bilateral cleft lip. In addition to having been pushed forward because of various reasons like the tongue thrust and things like that, and the unresisted forces of the oral perioral musculature, this premaxilla tends to get pushed forward. There are also instances that the premaxilla could get deviated on one side or the other. It could be fractured or it could be a simple deviation because of the bend in the omer. So we have all these issues that come up with the premaxilla, and how to manage a premaxilla by itself could be a complete lecture. I'll be throwing a little bit of light of this at the end of my talk. But before we get carried away by this difficult nature of bilateral cleft lip repair, let's try to simplify bilateral cleft lip repair and make it much more easily comprehensible by just restricting ourselves to the morphology which I mentioned earlier. Similar to the goals of unilateral cleft lip repair that we have similar goals in bilateral cleft lip repair. Now here, achieving the symmetry is much more easier because you are both the sides are in your hands. Whereas in unilateral cleft lip, you had only the cleft side in your hand and you had to design everything according to the template that was available, nature had given on the normal side. Whereas in a bilateral cleft lip, both the sides are in your hands. So you are going to decide about what is going to be the template. You can decide the dimensions. You can decide how you are going to incline the Cupid's bow. You can decide how long you want the filter column to be. You can decide how broad you want it to be. All this can be left to you. And this is something which is much easier as compared to unilateral cleft lip. Now, coming to the goals. The first goal is, as in unilateral cleft lip, to achieve a very well-balanced, continuous, symmetrical Cupid's bow. Now, if you see this lip repair here, the lip has been repaired here. But if you look at the Cupid's bow, it looks so natural and continuous. Now, this is one of the primary goal of bilateral cleft lip repair, as is it with a unilateral cleft lip repair. So, you have to achieve a continuous white roll which is symmetrical without any gaps in between or any distortions in between. This should be the primary aim. The second is you have to reconstruct a proper filtral architecture. What I mean by filtral architecture is you should have filtral columns on either side. You should have a filtral dimple in the center. The columns should be wider lower down, and as they move upwards, they should try to converge towards the columella. Now, this is the second goal. The third goal is to have a very harmonious free border of the lip. When I say harmonious, it should be continuous without any notching. At the same time, you should be able to reconstruct a good tubercle in the center. This gives an aesthetically pleasing free border of the lip. And this is third goal of a bilateral cleft lip repair. The next goal is to reconstruct the entire oral commissure and the perioral musculature. Now, what I mean by this, the abnormal attachments of the muscle from areas around the piriform fossa have to be released. The orbicularis oris muscle should be reconstructed over this premaxilla, and the continuity of the orbicularis oris muscle should be achieved. That various parts of the orbicularis oris, namely the nasalis, the peripheralis, and the marginalis, have to be oriented properly and also oriented in a manner that they create a proper pressure or a proper vector on the premaxilla. What I mean by a proper vector on the premaxilla is, when you have a premaxilla, are you all able to see my camera too? When the premaxilla is protruding forward, if you have a muscle repaired which is providing equal pressure throughout the anterior aspect, the premaxilla tends to move back in a proper manner. Suppose your muscle tension pressure is more on the upper part of the alveolus than the lower part, what happens is the alveolus starts tilting like this. So the premaxilla has an anterior tilt, and you get the upper lip gets pushed behind. If you increase the pressure in the lower part, then the premaxilla tends to get buckled in, and then you have the teeth pointing out inside into the oral cavity. So it's very important to get a uniform pressure throughout the anterior aspect of the premaxilla. Easier said than done. Getting a perfectly equal pressure all throughout that area is very, very difficult, and it can happen only once in a while when you do a proper lip repair. But that should be the ideal goal for us, to achieve this sort of a proper orientation of the lip musculature so that it can reposition the premaxilla in a proper manner. The next goal is to create a good gingivolabial sulcus. Now, this is a very important aspect of bilateral lip repair. As I mentioned, the sulcus is hardly formed in a bilateral cleft lip. It becomes very shallow. So it's very important to have it deepened. Now, this is required not only from the aesthetic point of view, but also from the orthodontic part of view. If in case the child requires orthodontic treatment at a later date, if the groove is not well formed, it's very difficult to apply orthodontic appliances to realign the teeth. So this is a very important part of the goal of a bilateral cleft lip repair. The next is, as is in unilateral cleft lip, to correct the nasal deformity as far as possible at the time of the lip repair. Now, the uniqueness of this sort of nasal deformity as compared to bilateral is not that in achieving symmetry on either side by dissecting on more on one side and trying to align the lower lateral cartilage on the cleft side to that of the non-cleft side. But in this case, it's very important to try to align both the lower lateral cartilages and try to reconstruct the columella and lengthen it. Now, however best we try, in spite of doing the best, they do tend to go and broaden. So one of the aims is to lengthen the columella as far as possible by trying to reposition the medial crura of the lower lateral cartilages and achieving a good dome. The second aspect is the LR flare, which is there, has to be reduced to as much extent as possible. Otherwise, the deformity, you get a very broad nasal base. So both these things have to be catered to, the lengthening of the columella and trying to correct the LR flare. So these are the requirements of a proper nasal deformity correction in a bilateral cleft lip. The next goal is to repair the anterior palate as much as possible. Now, this is not as easy as it is in a unilateral cleft lip. Because if you want to do a proper anterior palate repair, then you will have to do it on both the sides. Whereas in unilateral sides, it's simple. You raise the omorine flap on one side and suture it onto the under the cleft shelf of the palate on the cleft side. But here, you have to do that on both the sides. Now, if you try to do it extensively, there is a worry of devascularizing the premaxilla. If you try to remove the dissect this mucosa away from the bone on both the sides and make this dissection extensive, then you might end up with losing the vascularity of premaxilla. So your dissection and the way you raise these flaps and repair the anterior palate should be done very carefully so as to not compromise the blood vasculature of the premaxilla as far as possible. So this is one very important thing. If not, correcting the fistulae or the gaps that are present left behind after the lip repair becomes very difficult because these are on both the sides, and even correcting it with local flaps becomes very difficult. So most of the time we end up doing a tongue flap in these cases. So this is one more aspect of bilateral cleft lip, that we try to repair the anterior palate as far as possible on both the sides at the same time as that we are doing the lip repair. If this is very much difficult and it's just not possible to do it, then at least on one side, we should try to repair the anterior palate as far as possible. But the nasal floor on both the sides, you should try to correct. And the last aspect of the goal is you have to try to do all this with as minimal scars as possible. Now, those scars which occur in the filtral column, they do get camouflaged to a great extent, but the scars in this part can be visibly bad. So we have to try to achieve a good lip repair with minimal scarring or as less scars as possible. So once again, running through the goals, first one is to achieve a continuous, well-balanced Cupid's bow. Second is to reconstruct the filtral architecture, that is both the filtral columns and the filtral dimple. Then to form a harmonious, continuous free border of the lip vermilion without any notching or visceral deformity, and also forming a good lip tubercle in the center. anatomically realigning the premaxilla, which is protruded or deviated on either sides, to its normal position. And this is done by a proper orientation of all the lip and perioral musculature around the lip. Then is to create a good deep gingivolabial sulcus as far as possible, utilizing the tissue which is there in the lip. Then correcting the nasal deformity as far as possible. What I mean by nasal deformity is to lengthen the columella, achieve the lengthening of the columella by trying to bring the medial crura as far as possible together, and to correct the alar flare by bringing the alar bases closer to each other. Then is the closure of the nasal floor and the anterior palate as far as possible on both the sides, if very difficult, at least on one side, and all this with as minimum scars as possible. With these goals, let's go ahead with the reconstructive principles of bilateral cleft lip. Now, these principles are on similar line that I discussed the unilateral cleft lip, but here, as I said, the entire palette is in your hand, the canvas is in your hand. You don't have a template that you have to follow. You have to just have the aesthetic principles in your mind. Now, if you try to analyze a normal lip and a bilateral cleft lip, you will realize that this is the part which needs to be reconstructed in this lip. Now, what does this part contain? Now, this part is what obviously looks like as what is attached to the base of the columella. Whereas there are so many things deficient in this part as you compare from this. So those deficiencies have to be corrected in your lip repair. And where do we get these tissues to prepare this or reconstruct this is from the lateral elements. We have good amount of ample tissues in the lateral elements, which we can use to reconstruct this part of the lip. Now, coming to the part of the lip that we are planning to reconstruct, we can divide it into three parts. One, two, and three. The first part is the lip proper, which is there in the uppermost part, the base of which is formed by the columella base, and the lowermost part is formed by the upper end of the white root. Then beneath you have the vermilion, or what we call the free border of lip, which comprises both of the dry and wet vermilion in the center. And then we have the central white roll. Now, where will we get these tissues from when we are trying to reconstruct this? Now, it's very obvious that this part of the lip is available very much here, because this is attached to the base of the columella, and we have this much of tissue available, which is attached to the base of the columella, and this can be used to reconstruct this part of the very, very easily. Then comes the vermilion. Now, this vermilion, we all know it's deficient, greatly deficient in the center. Though in some cases, you might find a little bit of vermilion, but generally it is deficient. But we do have enough vermilion in the lateral element, and we can use this to reconstruct that part of the central vermilion. Lastly comes the white roll. Now, if in case the white roll is deficient here, then we will have to use the white roll from the lateral elements. But if you already have a good white roll here, we can still use the white roll. But in most of the cases, the white roll is not well formed here, and we end up using the white roll from the lateral elements. So if we look at this, this part of the lip can be reconstructed from here. Then we have the white roll, which along with the vermilion, that is, this part can be reconstructed from the lateral element. So we have the central part of the lip, which can be reconstructed from the prolabium. And we have this part of the lip right up to the center midline, which can be reconstructed by the lateral elements. Now, how do we do that? Is trying to get the tissues from the lateral element medially. You use this prolabial element to reconstruct this part, but the rest of it, you bring it from the lateral sides and then make them come to lie in the center so as to form the rest of the lip. We can also at times try to use more of the prolabium. If in case the white roll is good, we use it, and from the lateral elements, we don't take the white roll. We only take the vermilion and bring it in the center. So in this case, the white role is taken from the prolabium. The earlier technique, the white role was taken from the lateral element. That is what we call popularly the Mulliken's technique of lip repair. Now, when the white role in the central element is used to reconstruct the central part, this will be called the Manchester repair, just beneath the white role. Whereas you don't take white role from the lateral element. And the third technique, you can use more of this vermilion from the central element and reconstruct the dry vermilion also from this part. And only use the rest of the vermilion, the wet vermilion, and the other parts from the lateral element. And this technique we call as the black technique. So we have three different techniques here, which we basically know. The first one is the Mulliken's technique, wherein you are using the white roll from the lateral element. Then you have the Manchester technique, when you are using the white roll from the prolabial element in the final lip repair. And then you have the black technique, wherein you are not only using the lip and the white roll, but also the dry vermilion from the prolabial element to reconstruct the central part. So these are the three techniques which we need to stress on. There are so many other techniques mentioned. Now, those techniques depend upon whether you do one side at a time or both the side at a time, or you do a muscle repair or no, or whether you do what is called as lip addition, and so many other things. Like you have the Wu's technique, the Millard's technique, the triangular technique on both the sides. There are different techniques. But these are the three techniques which I feel, as a resident, you should be aware how you are going to do the lip repair, depending upon where you are taking the white roll and the dry vermilion from. With this background, let's move on to the bilateral lip repair. How do we do the marking in a bilateral lip repair? I'm going to mention here or explain to you all here the way in which the white roll is taken from the lateral element, that is the Mulliken's technique of lip repair. I won't confuse you all with the marking of so many different techniques. Once you know the principles, it becomes very simple as to how you are going to go ahead with the marking. Before we start, let's start identifying the different points. The first is the base of the columella. Now, the base of the columella is at the groove formed between the columella and the lip. That is very easy to identify, and it is the midpoint of the base of the columella. You will have to identify the direction in which the columella is going and then mark the midpoint of that base of the columella. That forms the midpoint of the lip. Then you mark the lowermost part on the lip, which will form the filtral element. Now, this will be the central part. Now, this will be continuous with the frenum that we have in the central portion of the lip, which gets attached to the alveolus or the premaxilla. So you can orient this depending upon that. So this will be the longest dimension of what you are going to have in the central lip. This is what is going to be the length. Now, don't get carried away that this is too small or too long. Once the lip repair is done, these dimensions change because of the stress and the stretch on these various points once you do the lip repair. So they do change to a great extent. Then we mark the either sides of the base of the columella. Now this will form the base of your prolabial flap, these three points. This entire thing will form the base of the prolabial flap, and this provides the vascularity to the prolabial flap. So you mark points equidistant from the midpoint of the columella base. Then you mark two points lower down. Now, these points should be equidistant from central to this point, as well as from this to this. So you have bilaterally symmetrical points marked on either sides. Then you have the alar bases and the angle of the mouth. Now comes the task of identifying which is that part of the white roll which is going to go right up to the center from the lateral element. Now this will depend. If you trace the white roll in the element, lateral elements, you can see either of the elements. If in case it is asymmetrical, then you look at the shorter element which is there and try to run along this white roll and identify the distalmost point where the white roll is well marked. Now you can use the entire white roll to reconstruct the lip cupid's bow. If you go further ahead, then the white roll will not be well marked. If you stay shorter, then you might have a horizontal short lip. So you should try to go as far as possible that you can have a good white roll seam. And that point is marked. And this point should be equidistant both from the angle of the mouth as well as from the alar bases, so that this point is symmetrical on either sides. So you identify this point, and this should be reconfirmed that it should be equidistant from both these sides. Then you will have to mark another point which is lateral to this point, the distance from which, from here to here should be equal to this distance. The distance from this point to this point should be the distance from this point to this point. So if you extrapolate and see, this is the white roll which is going to come to lie in between these two points. So this is the white roll which is going to form that part of the Cupid's bow from the deepest point to the highest point. Once you have marked both these points which are symmetrical on either sides, you will have to mark the point which is going to get sutured to this filtal column, or which is going to form the filtal column. So you mark this point on the edge of the lip such that the length of this is slightly more than the height of this. Now this is because when you start suturing, this element of the skin starts stretching. So this point, even if it is 1 or 2 millimeters more than this, it tends to get sutured very nicely because this prolabial element stretches down when you start repairing. Now you mark these two points. While you are marking these two points, you should also be sure that they are equal distant from the LR bases. So this also should be made sure so that your nasal sill, which will be formed, is also equal on both the sides. Then this is the pentagon sort of a structure, the base of which is in the upper part, that is the base of the columella. The filtal columns on either sides angulated narrower upwards and slightly broad lower down. And then from the lower point of these filtal column, two lines which go down right into the center, forming a sort of a pentagon, five-sided structure. These are the longest element, but equal on either sides. And these are the shorter elements, which are equal on either sides. Now this will form your prolabial element of this nature. This tends to stretch. So this many a times gets elongated to this sort of a dimension. Then these are the two points, the incision along with which will be forming these points here, as you see here. These two points have formed this point. Now these two points, the incision will
be here. Dr. Pawar, can I just interrupt you for a second, please?
Please. Yeah.
Yeah. The most important point in marking of and doing a bilateral cleft lip is actually the marking of the prolabium.
That's right.
So can you just explain once again, because I am there would be first years also, no, that how you actually do the central portion, that the lower portion.
Okay, let me go back to my marking once again. See, the first point is very simple to mark. This is the base of the columella. The base of the columella, what I mean by the base of the columella, is that groove or the junction which the columella forms with the lip. So when you have the columella reaching the lip and forming a sort of a fold there, a junction between the columella and the lip, at that point, you look at the thickness of the columella and mark the central point. So this will be the midpoint of your prolabial element in the upper extent. Now you'll have to mark your midpoint of the prolabial element in the lowermost extent. Now this is the point marked here. Now this point is the lowermost point that you can get in the prolabial element. But this should be in line with the frenum, that is the midline. So this is the midline of the prolabial element. Like this. This forms the midline of the lip, and this will form the future midline of the lip. Is that clear? First point? you try to take it as low as possible so that you get good length of the prolabium. Is this okay. clear? Yeah. Once this is clear, we move on to the next two points. Now, these are the points in the columella on either side of the midline, which will be the future uppermost points of the filtral column. Now, this is the filtral column you see in a lip. Now, this filtral column is moving like this and this moving like this. The uppermost point of the filtral column at the columellar base will be formed by these two points. And these two points are equidistant from the center. Now, similarly, these points will have to be marked in this prolabial element on either side of the midline so that they are equidistant from the central point.
Is there any particular length or is there, like we see here, the lateral most point of the column, anything like that?
Yeah. What I go by is try to mark the lateral most part of the columella so that we have enough vascularity for the prolabial element. You can use enough base from which the blood supply comes. But you can also go by measurements. What people do is mark this about 1.5 millimeter on either sides. It depends from person to person. Now, some people might mark it 2 millimeter on either sides. The broader you have it, the filtral architecture will become broad. And we should also remember, once you repair the lip, it tends to widen or stretch. So we try to keep it as narrow as possible. I go by the columellar base, but there are people who mark this by measuring about 1.5 millimeters on either side. So you have a 3 millimeter base here, which will provide the blood supply for the entire prolabium. Is that
yes. clear? Okay.
Yeah. Perfect. Now, this. Perfect. Okay. Now, then the next two points come, which are going to form the future highest point on the Cupid's bow or the lowermost portion points in the filtral column. Now, these two points have to be naturally equidistant from the central. Now, you can mark these two points from this center such that they are angulated upwards and they are equidistant not only from the center, but these are also equidistant from what the length is from here to here is should be equal to this to this. Now, there are ways in which we can mark these points. Now, some people will mark it higher up, some people will mark it lower down. Now, if you mark it higher up, your Cupid's bow becomes more angulated. If you mark it lower down, your Cupid's bow becomes more flattened. Is that clear? Now, what I do is in female patients, I like this Cupid's bow to be quite well pronounced. So in female patients, I mark these points slightly higher up. Whereas in male patients, I try to keep them slightly lower down. So a little bit of flattened Cupid's bow in a male child is okay. But in a female, I like to take it nicely angulated. So these points are marked in such a way that they are above this point, the distance or the length above this could be defined by individual surgeons. It depends from person to person. Now, in females, as I said, I mark them slightly higher. In males, I try to mark them as low as possible. But whatever it is, these have to remain within the skin element of this prolabium and not go into the vermilion. Is that clear? So this distance
and the width also, how would you?
Yeah, now there is another way also. Some people try to measure the width from this midline to this. Now, if you have taken 1.5 here, then we take 2 millimeters on either sides so that these filtral columns, the lower down, they angulate out. If you take them also 1.5, then your filtral columns become parallel to each other. But aesthetically, nice filtral columns will have to be angulated upwards. So this distance is more than this distance. Suppose you have taken 1.5, you could take 2 from this. Or if you take 1 from either side here, you could take 2 or 1.5. More and more people and more as you progress as a bilateral cleft lip surgeon, you start trying to keep your prolabium narrower and narrower. Initially, the fear is if you keep them too narrow, then you might compromise on the vascularity, or you might find it very difficult to suture when you are doing the lip repair. So that's why that block is there as to how narrow we can take. I personally, if you ask me to measure my prolabial element, I would keep it 1.5 mm on either sides in the upper part and 2 millimeters on the lower part. So I have a nicely angulated filtral column which converge upwards as they go and diverge when they come down. So if you want to take the measurements, then it would be 1.5 on either sides in the upper part and 2 on either sides. I personally don't like to put these figures when I'm talking to residents because it depends from person, patient to patient. Suppose we have an older child, will we make it as narrow as we would do it in an infant? Or if you have a very small infant with hardly any prolabial element, how broad are you going to be able to make it? So all these issues come up. So it's better to go by the principles as to how we mark it. You can always try to play safe when you're starting the bilateral cleft lip. If these are the first or second case that you are doing, then you try to stay safe and try keep them as broad as possible so that you don't mess up while handling the tissues and you don't compromise on the vascularity. But as you become trained as a bilateral cleft lip surgeon, you start trying to keep them as narrow because you realize that once you have used a narrow prolabium also, as the child grows, it tends to stretch and becomes quite wide. As you have seen in some of the photographs that I showed earlier in the presentation, the prolabium in those cases also was taken very narrow, but eventually they tend to stretch out. And you will see more of these things later on when I'm showing the results. So is that clear?
Perfect.
Yeah, okay. Then we move on to the incisions. So this will be the prolabium, which will form this part. And these incisions will close in the midline here on either side, forming the Cupid's bow. This distance, which is here, will approximate to this here and form these filter columns here. And these incisions will go right into the nasal cavity. And as you repair the lip, these tend to go more towards into the nose. If we have excess tissue here, we can always excise a wedge. If we don't, these will move into the nose, the nasal floor area. And then we have incisions on either sides of the vermilion, which will come and approximate to each other in the midline this way. So I hope you realize how the incisions are taken and how they come to close. Is that clear? Any doubts from the residents? You can stop me here and get them clarified. Don't carry your doubt further.
Sir, would you like to explain, sir, lateral lip markings once again, sir?
Yeah, okay, that's good. So I'll start showing the lateral lip markings once again. We have these points already identified, the alar basis, the angle of the mouth. Now, our identifying point is to use as much as the vitrol as possible from the lateral elements, which are going to come right up to the center and join here. So we should use as well-defined vitrol as possible. So as you trace the vitrol from the lateral part of the lip and come towards the center, you will see that at one point, the vitrol becomes less obvious. So you mark this extreme point where the vitrol is well formed, and that point has to be identified on both the sides. Ideally, both these points should be the same distance from the angle of the mouth as well as from the LR base. The vertical height on both the sides has to be the same, and the horizontal length on both the side has to be same. In case there is asymmetry and one side the lip element is smaller than the other, then identify the vitrol on the smaller lip element and correspondingly mark that point in the lesser available element. So you will be able to once again achieve that symmetry. Is that clear? So this point, once it is marked, and identified, you will have to mark identify the other point which is lateral to this. Now this will also be on the white road, and this distance that which you have marked will be the distance from here to here. This distance will be the same as this. Suppose this you have kept it as 2 millimeters, even this will be 2 millimeters, and that's how you identify this lateral point, 2 millimeters lateral to the previously identified point. And the white roll from in between these two points will form the white roll here, which will come into the center, because these points are going to meet each other in the center, and these points are going to form the heights of the cupid's bow on either sides. So this distance should be same as this distance. Then comes so, your
The points in the we are first point which we have marked on the lateral segment is Nodos point, isn't it?
Yeah, so? that is. If you want to mention it as a Nodos point, then it would be the Nodos point in a bilateral lip. Yeah, Nodos point is classically defined in the unilateral lip. That's where the white roll fades. Now this is the Nodos point in the bilateral lip. You can say that this is going to be the point where the white roll fades. That is the Nodos point.
So you are right. The three features what we determine in the unilateral cleft lip is the same as in this bilateral also, isn't it?
Also, yeah, that's right. That's right. We could put it that way. Only thing is we won't be able to identify the dry vermilion, which is the broadest there and things like that. But essentially, yeah, the height, the distance from the height, from the LR base and from the angle of the mouth, those two are fine, correctly identified. You're right. So that is the, then you have the next point identified, which is the point which will, the distance from this lateral point to that point will form the filtral column height. Now this point, if you see, it's not, the distance is not the same as this. This is slightly more than the filtral column height. Now this distance is more than this. I keep it about a millimeter or a millimeter and a half more than this, because when I start suturing the lip, once I suture these points here, this thing tends to get stretched down and this distance increases, and then I'm able to easily suture this point here and this point here. So this prolabial element, which doesn't have attachment of any muscles or anything acting on it in a bilateral lip, is pulled up. But once you start repairing it, it will start getting pulled down and the filtral column will be, the height will be increased. So that's why we mark this point with the length which is slightly more than the measured filtral column height in the prolabium in the central segment. Now the second distance we should keep in mind is that it should be horizontally symmetrical also. So from the LR base, this distance also should be equal. So you can adjust this point accordingly so that this distance is equal to this distance and this distance is equal to this distance, which is slightly more than this distance. Is that clear? The resident who had asked me this, is the marking of these points clear?
Sir, the longitude means vertical and you have marked on lateral aspect. That should be equal in height to the marking laterally on the central segment. That's it.
Not central segment, the lateral. This is the filtered column. Yeah. Ideally, it should be equal. But I have marked it more than this, because we have noticed that when we start suturing, this tends to get vertically stretched.
Okay, sir.
So this distance I am marking more than what this is. I normally mark a millimeter or a millimeter half more than this measured height. Is that clear?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Right. So with these points marked, the prolabium will be a pentagon sort of a structure with the base, the vascular base or the base of that flap at the columella, which will form this part of the lip. And these incisions between these two points will form the white roll of the cupid's bow in this part here. And these incisions from this point to this point will form the pilteral column heights on either sides here. They will join here. And then you extend this incision right into the nasal sill area and the nasal floor, so that once you start repairing this, this comes and approximates here. This automatically gets rotated inside. In case you find that there is excess of tissue, you can excise this wedge. Otherwise, you can leave it behind. Is that clear?
Yes.
Okay. So okay. Then the last vertical point here, incision that you are taking, you try to use as much as vermilion as possible, because if you add more vermilion, you'll get a better lip tubercle. So you take as much as the vermilion in this vertical incision, and this will form the central sutured line here. I also use these lateral elements. Now these lateral, there is so much of tissue available here. What I do is, take this much of tissue and incorporate it as a de-epithelized skin. You'll see in the video how I manage it, so that I have excess tissue on either sides of the filtral column, that is the subcutaneous tissue, not the skin. And this tends to lie beneath the suture line. And this excess tissue gives the prominence of the filtral column in the lipoid lip. So you'll see how I do it in the video. Now the surgical technique, this is a video.